everything went well there. Not next Saturday, but the next, we're going to go out to eat at the Colonial Fish Camp. So come and join us that night as well, that Saturday, the 25th at 6:30. That's always a good time as well, with some good food too. And as far as other announcements, looks like Tom Dooley is having a birthday tomorrow. So happy birthday to Tom. And he's getting a little bit younger, right, Tom? Yeah. And then we also have an anniversary coming up. Lee and Sandy's having an anniversary. And that'll be on Valentine's Day, on Tuesday. So happy anniversary to those two as well. And on our prayer list, continue to remember Wanda. She's still got a little hacking and coughing going on. She's doing better, though. We praise God for that. Also, Connie's granddaughter, Paisley, is down with the flu. So remember Paisley. And I think Minnie Lou has a great grandson who has the flu as well. So remember him as well. That flu can be a very difficult thing to go through. And I think that's all I have, unless you have others or any more comments on these things. Oh, okay. Yeah, we do have hot water installed now. We're just waiting on some electrical work done, but the water part's done. It's a nice-looking water heater. Should never, ever run out of hot water now. You can run it all day. So we're thankful for that. We didn't need it last night. If we'd had a drop cord, we could have had it last night, too, but I didn't. Nobody knew that, though, but the washing dishes now. So we're going to have a service going, right? You bring dirty dishes, get them washed, and we pay for the water heater. So, yes, a nice-looking unit, and they did a great job installing it. It's a nice-looking installation, so we're thankful to God for that as well. Oh, yeah, we have a new addition to a ramp. Remember last week we had a fellow in a wheelchair came in, and we're having to lift him over the little hump. Well, now there's a nice ramp by this door, and we got to get the latch fixed on the door, which is in the process. And I want to thank Lee and I can't remember your buddy's name. Stan Burgess put that ramp in. It looks great. They did a wonderful job. And it looks like it took some work to do that, too. You had to break up some old concrete. Not, man, they did a great job. So thank you, Lee. And tell Stan we appreciate it, too. So anything else? We had a lot going on around here this week. Man, it's unbelievable. That's great. Yes. Right. That's true. That's true. All right. Thank you very much. You're always pray for our leaders. There's things going on all the time, some we know about and some we don't. And they always need our wisdom. They need wisdom. And the best place to get it, of course, is from God himself. We hope that's where they look for wisdom. Anything else? Well, if not, let's look to our God in prayer as we open our service this morning. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, again, we do thank you so much for the wonderful things you have done for us this past week. We thank you, Lord, that you, by your hand, have brought us here together to come and to worship you this morning. We ask, O Lord, that you be with our worship, that all that we do would please you, that it would glorify you, and that we would take your word in and take it with us and use it this week. And again, our God, you are so gracious to us. We thank you for prayer, a wonderful thing you have given us that we can approach your throne and pour our hearts out before you. And we thank you that you have taught us and how to pray. Be with us now as we pray the prayer together you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to look at two different scriptures this morning. If you first turn in your Bibles to Galatians chapter 6, verses 2 through 10. That's chapter 6 of Galatians 6 through 10. Let's hear what the Word of God has to say to us. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, restored, such as and one in spirit of meekness, consider thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself.
But let every man prove his own work, that in which then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in others. For every man shall bear his own burden. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived, God is not mocked, for whosoever a man soweth, that which he also reapeth. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall be the Spirit reap life everlasting. Let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Thanks be reading to God's word in Galatians. Now I'd like to turn to 1 John chapter 3, beginning with verse 18. That's 1 John chapter 3, beginning with verse 18. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And nearly we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do good, do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is the commandment, that we should believe on the name of the Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that there abideth in us by the Spirit which have given us. Thanks be reading God's word in 1 John. Well, Tuesday's Valentine's Day. Man, just thought I'd give you a little reminder there. We know what we're going to do. We're going to run out Tuesday, and before we get home, we're going to find something if it's at the convenience store. And at the convenience stores, I noticed they got, some Valentine cards. Some of them about this tall, big old things. So if you want to show how much you love, and I was a kid, I thought the bigger the card, the more you love. And if you got perfume, the bigger the ball of the perfume, what? The more you love. So, bigger sometimes not better, of course. Now, when the world seems to be in love with love, which is 14th, this brief day in the dead of winter, 70 degrees, which we love, is not considered at all out of place to express our love. And we express it openly in front of others. We express the whole thing. And we want to show our love. Of course, the stores are showing it quite a bit. And our kids, grandkids are going off to school with what? These little Valentine cards, and to give to their little friends. And then you got the teenagers that's texting on a smartphone. Nowadays they do that instead of sending the card. And then you got the grown-up men and women. We ring their own doorbells for the wife to come to the door, and you got some flowers you picked up at Walmart somewhere maybe, and so here you go, honey, this is Valentine's Day. So we have a lot of things going on during Valentine's to show our love, and we showed our love last night. A lot of us, we split the men and the women up and had teams there, and we did show our love with one another. We didn't bash too bad, and we ended up in a tie. If anybody's interested, we tied, so we were equal, and we have peace this morning. So do you know where Valentine's Day come from? Originally, it was St. Valentine's Day. Remember, it used to be called St. Valentine's? Well, they've taken the saint off because the Roman Catholic Church is no longer, Valentine's is no longer a saint. They have decommissioned or decanonized him a while back, along with St. Patrick, St. Christopher, and a host of others. They said, well, they're saints no more, and it's back then, so we're going to take them off the saint list. So, but the real person, or no, is a legend that lives on. And this is kind of how the story goes, if you do not know how Valentine's come. His name was Valentinus. He was a Christian living in ancient Rome. And it was a time of persecution when the emperor issued a decree commanding citizens to worship Roman gods only. And Valentinus was one of those who refused, and he was sentenced to death. Now, while he was in prison, a Roman guard came up to him and asked him, said, would you kind of help my daughter a little bit? He recognized the man as a learning man. Valentinus was very smart and loved to learn and read. So he asked him to tutor his daughter, Julia, which is a beautiful young girl who happened to be blind. So day after day, Valentinus told Julia of the world that he could see and let her see it through his voice and his teaching. And he told her of his God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ. And as their friendship grew, Julia admitted how she yearned for sight, wondering what it would be like to behold the worlds of beauty. And her teacher said and had described to her, Valentina says, assured her, for those who believe in God, anything's possible. Julia became a Christian, and one day shortly after, as the two sat quietly in prayer, the prison cell was filled with a brilliant, bright white light. Julia cried out in amazement, saying she could see, she had been healed. Soon after, Valentinus was notified that the time of his execution was near, and he wrote Julia a farewell note, urging her to keep the faith, and he signed it, "From your Valentinus," like from your Valentine. So we would say, from your Valentine, of course, his death sentence was carried out the next day, February the 14th, 270 AD. So the legend goes on to tell Julia planted a pink blossom of an almond tree near his grave as a symbol of her unending love, love of God and her Valentine. That's kind of a sweet story, even if it's, we don't know if it's true or not, but it just kind of makes a good romantic story, doesn't it? And it shows a love that this person shared with this blind girl, a love about God. That's the wonderful thing about God. He's the one created love. We mix love up in different ways, in different words, when people say it really loosely, and we've spoken of this before. When someone speaks about love, I love you, I hear it all the time, and the person hasn't even seen you, they don't know you, but they'll tell you they love you. And sometimes, one day, I'm going to take that experiment to the fullest when someone tells me that I don't even know, and bye, I love you. And to me, love means a different thing. I might go to her house next weekend. I come to spend the weekend with you because you love me so much. How do you think that's going to go off? Y'all can come bail me out because I know I'll be arrested. But this is a touching story, and there's nothing in it to indicate that the love between Valentinus and Julia was romantic, as we call it today. But yet the tale is growing between the two unlikely people, a condemned man and a blind girl. These two of them found each other, and their lives were changed. And God's love will change your life and change others' life. Others' lives that will be changed in an instant, or maybe on down the road. Now, when scientists talk about love, yeah, we got to get the scientists in here because, you know, they know all about love, right? And they incline to talk about it as chemistry, and not the chemistry that we usually think about, oh, we seen her and I fell in love, we had that chemistry between each other. They look at it as a literal sense, and they were convinced there's a chemical in the brain that accounts for love. And they're trying to isolate it in a laboratory, and I hope they never do, because a lot of us don't believe there's something there. Now, we always talk about a heart, you know, we love you, and we see the Valentine hearts and stuff like that, but it's coming from our brain, and that love that we feel in our heart makes a heart leap in other sense. But most of us, I'd venture to say, are more romantic than that. Can you see, happy chemistry day, this is my brain saying to you, happy chemistry day of Valentine's. Now, wouldn't that sound awful? It wouldn't be. We believe in lovers finding one another for reason other than chemistry. So, we look at things like our marriage vows. Now, we had renewal vows here recently, last year, and we believe that true love is forever. And I believe there's a good reason for Christians to celebrate romantic love. Because the romantic love, and we believe in the marriage, when we said your vows, and we've had many weddings here in this church over the years, I know. And one thing I tell the bride and the groom to do, face each other, not facing me, because they're not marrying me. They're marrying each other. And this way they're looking at each other, and they're seeing that love and compassion there. Do you know who's the greatest romantic of them all? And some of you are going to say, Valentino, or one of them stars, or whatever like that. But actually, God is. God created love. This inner eye that is able to see not only the body, but not only the personality, but the soul of the one that we love. Yes, the one that we love, God knows that person's soul, knows that person's love, and also knows you. He created love. God made us for relationship. In marriage, the Bible says, a man leaves father and mother and cleaves to his wife, and they become one flesh. So he gives a helper there, and we cleave to one. We're no longer under our parents. We become one to kind of learn together in love. Now that coming together in commitment, lifelong love, is one of the greatest things in the world. Ask Joanne and Bobby. Now we pick on, Bobby and I pick on our wives a lot. And we do it out of love, even though we get scolded for it. But we would take nothing for our wives because we love them. And part of that love is just not a one day a year. It's a continuing love where we look at each other and we see that love, that deep and great love that God has given us for each other. And that's not to say, of course, that marriage is for everyone. Because you got a lot of people that hasn't married, and it isn't. Marriage is a form of discipleship, and it is not everyone's calling. It's like it's not everyone's call to be a pastor, to be an elder. Yet, married or no, every Christian ought to be interested in marriage. But it is one of the most vital institutions in our society, and one of the most endangered in our society. All the television programs are showing more and more of single parents, where one, either the father or the mother, is out of the picture. It's showing more and more of living together out of wedlock. It's showing more and more things against what God has taught us in His Word. It's becoming one of the most endangered marriages. Now, it's been said that no couple stays married for the same reason they got married. I believe that. I believe when we first got married, we was just so filled of love. It was just unreal, wasn't it? We wouldn't plan in the future or anything. We wouldn't plan on what's the next year, whatever like that, because we was in love. I'd look at it and I'd say, oh, let me help you do the dishes. Let me get those done. Now, Edna, you ain't got the dishes done yet? So our love changes around a little bit, doesn't it, than we first. Young man that lives down below me was talking about relationship that when he gets graduated, that him and his girlfriend, they're going to get out of town and leave Union. Well, one thing, he has no vehicle or license. She don't either. I said, well, how are you going to get there? I don't know. Well, how are you going to get a place to live? I don't know. I said, well, why are you going to leave? We're in love. So, that's going to be an interesting tale to see one day. But the love that draws a couple together in young adulthood is not the same love that we keep together. Now, when you're loved, you have birth, you have children, and you triumph midlife and challenges of old age, you see love in a different manner, don't you? You grow more and more in love. I never tell anyone I fell in love because I always got this mentality, I fall out of love. We grow in love because we grow each day, don't we? Each day is a new excitement. I know it is in our house, and I bet you it is in Joanne and Bobby's house too. Every day is a good day. But when God puts you together, and you got God first in your lives, all the other challenges will work itself out because you have God that's got that love there. Now, the scientist tells us that every 7 years, our skin cells regenerate. It's almost every 7 years, we got a new body. I said, wow, that means, Bobby, that we every 7 years, we go back to one. So if we figure up our age now, I'm only like about 28 years old. And my skin looks it, according to scientists now. Now, cells are constantly dying and replacing itself, of course, and every 7 years, and so we've got a whole new set of them. But something very similar is true of the person we are inside. And none of us are the same person today that we were 7 years ago. Can you see that? Can you look back 7 years ago, and during those 7 years, are you the same person? Of course not. Because you're growing in wisdom, you're growing in more knowledge, and you're growing more in love closer to God. That's wonderful. That's wonderful a place to be. So, growth is a lifetime process, and so too is love. It's a lifetime process. You can't pin love down, dissect it, and study it. We can do it and try it, but it doesn't work, does it? Look at all the books. I see, there's all these books on how to love your mate, how to better do this right here, how to do this. And I pick up one book that's talking about how you to absorb and teach you how to love. And I look up the author. He's only been loved and 4 wives so far. So immediately I put that book back because I knew that's not going to work for me because apparently it didn't work for him, did it? Something very similar is true of the person we are inside. And the change that we make in our lives, and as we grow closer to God, our love gets stronger and stronger. We have more compassion between our mates. We have more compassion towards others. There's no good marriage that does not also contain within it some potential of failure. And by the same token, there is no failing marriage that does not contain within it some potential for new life. We're all vulnerable. Ed and I, Bobby, Joanne, Lee, Sandy, we're all vulnerable. And we all have that potential of failure. But when we got God in our life and strengthening our marriage and strengthening the way we love makes it better. It gives us some strongness. And the ones that their marriage is on rockiness, there's potential for new life to be in a marriage. I always tell someone that I'm counseling that's having a rough time in marriage, I always ask them, what did it feel like on your first date? Everybody remember your first date? I do. I remember. And it questions me. I better remember. Remember when we got to eight and what she did. I think think she wrote me a thank you note in calligraphy, but she had shown me all her skills. And I knew that I'll be back. And we've grown more and more over the years, stronger than we ever have from the beginning. But I always ask that person that's in trouble, what about that first date? What about that first year? How was it like? Was it just grand? Was it wonderful? What are some of the things you do? And they would tell me. And in telling me this right here, I would gather it up and say, you know what? Why don't you do it right now? Why don't you have come home and if you've never been out on a date night, go out on one. I'm taking you out on a date. What? And the best, just play it like you did before. Now, you just didn't walk over to the girlfriend's house. I didn't just show up at Enda's house and knock on the door and say, okay, let's go. We're going to Burger King. No. I called her up and says, hey, how would you like to go here? So even being married, and I tell a couple, if when it's having some problems, call her up from your work, stop on the side of the road, and say, hey, get fixed up. We're going on a date. And that would be surprising to them. And I guarantee you, men, the women will love it. And on that date, what did you do on your first date? Did you bring any flowers or anything like that? Why not now? Don't wait until Valentine's Day. Okay? All through your life. We are different, men and women. Not only that, any two individuals coming together in relationship are also different. We're all different. And we have that potential of new life. Now, there are clashes of family background, upbringing, traditions. We all have that, don't we? We have some people on one side of the family, the other, that we talk about. And even though we talk about our troubling family, of course not us, right? It's always on the other side. It's like I told, and we're driving down the road, and I was a little miffed at her, and I looked out through there, and there was this field of pigs. I said, some of your kin folks, isn't it? It didn't go over too well until she looked at me and said, yeah, sure is. That's my in-laws. So, we all have these things different in our families. And sometimes even religious faith is different, isn't it? It sometimes seems a miracle that two people can come together at all. And turning toward each other is a committed relationship. So we really get to where at one point, have you seen couples, he says, they don't match, do they? That's like night and day. How in the world do they match up? They might say that about me and Bobby and Connie and Reggie and all those right here. Somebody's going to say, well, how do they match up together like that? Because, you know, I'm kind of a jokester, does some things like that, and Enda's real mild and meek. And it looked like we would really clash, and we do sometimes, but I'll get over it. But we ourselves, we turn to each other when we're here. When you say your vows for that commitment, you turn toward each other and taking one another's hand. So many of us have done this right up here in the sanctuary, and we repeat our vows of lifetime faithfulness. And we did that last year. And we got our commitments even on the wall out here, so men can't get out of it. But we all come together holding hands with a lifetime, lifelong faithfulness. Now, turning towards each other is more than a one-time occurrence in marriage. Long-term relationships. So in order for that sort of commitment to succeed, the two partners also must return to each other sometimes. Over a length of time, we need to sit down sometime. It could just be on the off the wall and look at your wife or husband and say, I love you. I love what you've done for me. I love you because of whatever. And I did Edna this way one day. He was eating breakfast or dinner like that. And I forgot what I said to her. She was the best wife. She's, well, thank you. She was just shocked. Because us men, we take it for granted, don't we? And sometimes we just don't see it. But we need to do it more. And wives, same way. You need to do the same thing. Wives will do it more quicker than men because we got this macho thing. But we need to do that sometimes. We need to look at each other and remind each other about our love. There's much in the world that would seek to turn us from commitment, to deflect us from our resolve to be faithful. And yet, it's not the turning away that truly makes a marriage, but the returning. There's a lot of people out there that want to see your marriage fails. They want to step in and take over. And when you're married a good length of time, you might feel flattered. Oh, wow. This younger woman, she flirted with me. But I guarantee you, that younger woman has no match to your wife. Because one thing, she's got you broke in. And we know our hearts. We know each other. We know our faults. And I would really hate to start over, trying to learn all that over again. It would drive me nuts. But what would drive us closer is with God's love for what He did for us as in a marriage. It's worthwhile pointing out on Valentine's Day or any other time that love is more than hearts and flowers. It is, as 1 John tells us, word or speech, but truth and action. Word and speech. That's pretty good, because we know we can always say words, can't we? Always say it. But truth and action, that's where it's at. That's where it shows your love. We can tell our spouses all day long, we love you. But if we don't show it, will they believe it? No. They sure won't. There's a tendency in our speech, our society, to think love begins and ends with feelings. But it's much more than that. Love is also an act of the will. Our feelings. Look how much our emotional feelings are, right? And if you really want to see how people's emotions and feelings are, sign up for Facebook. And they will throw it all over there, their feelings. And how their day is, and how this person is, and blah, 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 right here. That's not love. Love is an act of will, and that act comes from God. God inputs to us. C.S. Lewis is said to have remarked this: in the early stages, love keeps marriage together, but there comes a time when marriage keeps love together. So you see, in one early stage, love keeps the marriage together. But it comes a time when marriage keeps love together. Because you look at each other. You've been with each other so long. You know the thoughts. And it tells me all the time, I know what you're thinking before you do. I believe her. It scares me. But that's part of our love together, our connection. That God has brought us together as one. We all know marriage is under fire today. Some claim it's a dinosaur. And any other consensual relationship is good as anything. I don't believe that. How many think not married and not in a relationship, they just run out like the wind. So if you find this Valentine's Day that your Valentine is a man or woman to whom you once turned to in marriage, then you are to be commended. And to the two of you, I also say many happy returns to that spot, to that place where you said the vows of love that God gave you and that you said that day when you got married. Happy Valentine's Day. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the blessings you've given us today, and thank you for the love, Father. You created love. You are love. May you guide us, Father, for the rest of our lives. As we are married people, Father, we ask that you will continue to be the God of love in our life. In Jesus' name, amen.